The following presentation was recorded at the 2012 Southeast Linux Fest in Charlotte, North Carolina. It is licensed under a Creative Commons license. For more information about the Southeast Linux Fest, visit www.southeastlinuxfest.org. The Southeast Linux Fest would like to thank the following Diamond sponsors in 2012 for helping make these videos possible.
Welcome to everyone to Southeast Linux Fest 2012. In case you didn't know, this is our fourth annual event, and we will be here next year in Charlotte around the same time, June 8th or so, that weekend, so stay in touch. I hope you all have enjoyed the fest so far. I know I have. Thank you for coming. We do this all for you, and I hope you've enjoyed it. Hopefully you've heard already, and this won't be news to you, but I want to make it clear for everyone. Fill out your surveys for today. Turn them in. That's your ticket for the raffle this afternoon, so evening, right after our keynote. A few other things. If you've been to a SELF before, you know that normally the guy that would be doing this announcement would be Dave Yates. He was the president of Southeast Linux Fest for the first 3 years, but he was not able to join us this year. We have a shirt that we want to present to him after the fest, and he would be very tickled pink, I'm sure, if everyone just covered that up with signatures, so that'd be great if you do that. Mark Hinkle was a longtime supporter. He was scheduled to speak here, and David Nally actually had to give a lot of his talks for him because he was not physically able to walk, unfortunately. So we got a shirt for him as well, too. We're doing the same thing. And put a pin in the map to show us all where you're from. I was there when a guy from Australia put a pin in, so I think he's probably got the farthest around trip to us. So, without further ado, I'm not in the computer industry, I'm in something else, so I don't read a lot of articles, but I do read a few. And there's a few authors with which I'm familiar, and we're very honored to have one of those with us here tonight. He's a longtime Linux enthusiast and journalist as well. He currently works for CBS and ZDNet. So please join me in giving him a warm welcome, Mr. Stephen J. Vaughn Nichols.
Hi, folks. Can you hear me back there? Are we good? Yay. So hard to tell. Actually, I'll need you and the mic here back in a moment. I'm going to talk a little bit today about the history of Linux, something I know a little bit about since, well, I wasn't a Linux user from the very beginning, but I was pretty close to the very beginning. I came on board about a year or so after Linux got started. Before then, I'd been using things like Unix, and the first Unix I ever used was on a PDP-11. Which dates me, I know. So yeah, I see a few of you going, yep, you were there too, back in the bad old days. And before that, of course, I was using BSD. Ah, wow, the sound has suddenly gotten much louder. Interesting. Anyway, so let's just get started with my little brief history of Linux. I'll need someone with a mic up here. I know there was someone with a mic a moment ago. Person with the mic. Hello. There we go. Because alas, my computer presentation, such as it is, in its poor pathetic state, this computer doesn't handle sound. So let's see if we can get this to go. Nope. We are not getting sound here. Darn it all. Bad computer. Okay. So much for that. Well, you were going to see a cute little presentation about Linux that the Linux Foundation put out last year. It's really sweet, it's really cute. I can tell you all about it, but that's gotta be the most boring thing on the earth. So I'm not gonna bore you with that. So suffice it to say, it's 1991. There's this guy named Linus Torvalds. He's a Finnish graduate student who for some reason wants to create an operating system of his very own. It's not going to be anything big like GNU. Yeah, everybody remembers the GNU operating system, right? Okay, but anyway, he had a small dream, And he used an existing system called Minix. Any Minix users out there? Anyone who remembers Minix? Oh my, yeah, a few people, good. It's nice to know I'm not the only one. And so he took Minix and he started working on it. And so he sent out this little note on Usenet and saying, this is what I'm doing. And 21 years later, here we are. Linux is now old enough to drink, vote, get drafted, and you know, all those other things that we like penguins and ourselves to do. Though, as Linux himself says, actually Linux has about four different birthdays. There's this one, which was the original Usenet post. But before that, he had put out the word that, you know, he was thinking about doing this. Did other people think it was a good idea? And then he actually did some little bit of release testing. 0.01 never showed up anywhere. Same thing for 0.02. 0.03, a couple of months after this came out, was the first one that you could actually put out there, try to run, and it would break. But, you know, hey, he was the first one that was out there. And then a little bit later that year, he came out with the first real one. Now, to give you a little bit of background on what's going on here, this is 1991. Windows 95 doesn't exist yet. It's still 4 years away. There are free operating systems out there already, though. Those operating systems were the, anyone? Okay, the BSDs, exactly so. So you might think, well, why didn't he do it just to use a BSD? I mean, they were already out there. The source code was there. But, you know, he was really interested in operating system theory. He wanted to get his hands dirty. He was a hacker's hacker. So off he would go, and he would build his own system, which at the time, again, he thought would be really small, only work on AT hard disk, and he did not in any way, shape, or form see what was coming. And so what's the first thing that always happens when you have a new nifty idea and you bring out to the world for the first time in the open source community? Why, yes, you have flame wars. I mean, how can you not? I mean, this is open source. You have to have a fight. And the very first thing that happened was, after, you know, it was out there, it was running, was a guy named Andrew Tannenbaum, who had created the Minix operating system, which was basically a version of Unix just for teaching people operating system theory and practice. Which, by the way, if you really want to know the basics of how to run an operating system, how it actually works, still go out and find Tannenbaum's books on operating systems. They're still the best things out there for the basics. They really are. But at the time, he looked upon Linux's work and said, you've got to be kidding. This is not the way to go. This monolithic kernel stuff, ugh, awful, the very idea. And they screamed, they fought. And, you know, in some way, and though Linus and Andrew have since made up, let's be real. Here we are in 2012, and what do we often do when we get together? We scream, we fight, we have flame wars. Some things never, ever change, I'm sorry to say. But Linux does become successful. It becomes successful even though the BSDs are out there. It becomes successful even though Tannenbaum poo-poos it in academic circles. People start using it. The very first of these systems, these distros that do not require you to take the source code from an FTP site, run make, and all the rest on it, starts showing up. The very, very first one, you know, you can debate about all day, but I like to think it's either Bootroot, which nobody remembers now, or something called NCC Linux. Now, all of these distributions are basically totally amateur efforts. The one that MCC Linux usually gets the credit because it's the first one that's really publicly available. There's an FTP site at the University of Manchester in the United Kingdom. If you really wanted a Linux that you did not have to do everything by hand, that's the one that you got. But it doesn't really last that long. And there's a couple of others. Tamu comes to mind, or actually off my list. But there was one very early Linux in 1993, which survived into this very day. Now then, class, because I know some of you people who are developers in it are here today, what was that? Oh, come on, it's up on the screen, you can read it. All together, Slackware, exactly. It is still with us today, still running, and actually it's a pretty darn good distro. So it's actually coming up on its 20th birthday really soon now, which when you think about it, since Slackware is really a purely community-based system, that's actually pretty darn impressive, and I think demonstrates again how you don't need a large company behind you or anything. All you really need is hackery skills and ability. And that's going to be a very important thing here in these first few years of Linux, because that's really all that it's got going for us in these really early days. And let's see if I can get this to work. 1993, though, I mean, Slackware is not particularly, you really have got to be in the Linux world to know what Slackware is. On the other hand, you just need to be even, if you're even marginally in the Linux universe, you've heard of this one, Debian. Comes out from a guy named Ian Murdoch, somewhere in the Midwest. I forget if he's, do you remember if he's at, he's a advanced, yeah, that's what I thought. He was in Indiana, then he moved over. The name comes from, his first name is Ian. His girlfriend at the time's name was Debbie. You put them together, you get Debian. It is not from the Debian slime devil in Star Trek, I hate to tell you. But that's what Ian tells me anyway. Now, admittedly, they did break up afterwards, so maybe. Yeah, but yeah, then they broke up. Yes, exactly so. Okay, Debian, of course, is still with us today. Now, it's not as widely used as many of the others, but how many of you, for example, are Ubuntu users? Right. Okay, if you're using Ubuntu, congratulations. Debian is at the heart of Ubuntu. If we didn't have Debian, we could not have Ubuntu. It's really that simple. Now, you may ask, well, if Debian is so important, I mean, you're using Ubuntu, right? Why didn't Debian ever become the big distribution? And the reason, as Ian would agree were he here, is that the Debian community is, I was talking about Flame Wars earlier. You haven't seen Flame Wars until you've been in the Debian development community. They fight, they scream, they throw things, they yell. It's really pretty amazing they get anything done. But even as they throw out leader after leader saying, how dare you try to be commercial? How dare you introduce anything proprietary? How dare you disagree with me? Somehow or the other, they actually produce darn good code and a darn good distribution. They just do it really, really slowly. Yeah, so slowly that another guy, as we're going to see in a few years, decides he's had enough of this really slow development cycle. He'd like to speed things up a little bit. Some guy named Mark Shuttleworth. You may have heard of him. Zipping right along here, or trying to anyway. Okay, then another little company comes up. A guy named Mark Ewing comes up with this idea for Red Hat Linux. Now, Mark's more of a developer guy. I hope he's not here, but he wouldn't disagree with that. And he puts together this Linux, which is pretty darn good. Uses a little Slackware, a little bit of this, a little bit of that, comes up with it, calls it Red Hat. You know, I really don't know why. I should ask sometime. And someone knows? Yes. Nope. Okay. I thought someone knew. Yep. Yep. Now we know. That would have been my guess, but I honestly was not sure of that. Now, so he had his small business and so on. He was doing the distro, but you know what? That really wasn't his passion. And Bob Young, who's much more of a business guy, came along, and he decided, you know what? I think I could turn this into a business. So they get together. They make a deal. He merges it. Bob also has his own distro, which is, well, let's not talk about Bob's distro. Let's just say that Mark's was a lot better and that he realized that. And together they form Red Hat Linux, which is the most successful business Linux to this very day. Moving ahead and off to sort of a tangent, because I'm not going to get to it in here, Bob is no longer connected with Red Hat. Instead, he went out and he founded another company. And trivia question, who knows the other company that Bob Young went and founded? Lulu, right, the ebook publishing company. And they're not bad either way, but Bob's a friend of mine, so if you want to publish an ebook and you don't want to go the Amazon, the great South American river route of Amazon, talk to Bob and Lulu. They're not bad. They're really not. Okay, Linux is starting to get really popular around now. It's 1995. Windows 95 is out there now. I think that's reason enough for Linux to get popular, if you remember Windows 95 and its first iteration. I do, God knows. And the first Linux get-together, just like the one we're at today, is started. And would any of you happen to know where that first Linux show was? Yep. It was here in North Carolina. It was put together by a guy who was the head of the computer lab at North Carolina State, who was a big Linux enthusiast. And so actually, we are here in Charlotte. We are not at all far from the beginning of the first mass get-together. You know, we'd had Linux user groups before, LUGs. And this was actually, Linux Expo was the first, basically meant to be the grand get-together of all LUGs. It only lasted for about 4 or 5 years, but it started a movement which exists today. Because, you know, you have the other shows like Linux World and so on, and now you have Linux Expo and so on, which are put on by either companies or commercial groups. But the very first shows, and just like this show here today, are not put on by professionals. They're not put on by businesses. They're put on by people who love this stuff. And so it's really, it starts here in Carolina, and it goes on from there. Okay, now at this point, there are already GUIs around, okay? They're not particularly good, though. They're really just X window system with a little bit of other stuff put on there. If you really want to do anything, at this point, you're still shell programming. Like I like to say, at this point, the big debate is not about whether it's KDE or GNOME that's better, or Mint, or rather Cinnamon, or what have you. No, the big debate on interfaces at this time, are between Bash and Corn Shell and C Shell. By the way, the correct answer is Bash, okay? It was the one true interface, still is the true interface as far as I'm concerned. But these folks get together and they create KDE, and KDE actually works pretty well. Again, there are other systems out there. There's something from a company called SCO called Open Desktop, or Open Def Trap, as we like to consider it back then. And this was before we hated SCO, by the way. It was already Open Def Trap. But this, running on top of X Windows, KDE, I believe that's actually a photograph of KDE 1.1. Could be wrong about that. I forget exactly when I took it now. It was a long time ago. Worked pretty well, but it had a problem that a lot of people in the Linux community had real trouble with. Anyone happen to know what that trouble was with KDE? Yes? It was like Windows? Well, yeah, that's one, but that's actually not why people got cranky about it. Right, proprietary software, the Quat Toolkit. Qt Toolkit, exactly so. So, this is going to be a continuing fight. Open source is the phrase is around by now. It's no longer just free software, it's open source software. And you have Qt, and their license is not really all that compatible with the GPL v2. Not compatible at all, really. And so there's much screaming and there's much fighting. Remember what I said about Flame Wars at the very beginning? Here we go again. You know, this is awful, this is horrible. Ick, poo, ack. Nonetheless, KDE is pretty darn popular because, just like today, when you have purists say, no, we don't want, say, Adobe Flash in our distribution. There are people who say, well, I may not want it, but I need it. It works. Leave me alone. Okay. The next year, we've talked about Red Hat, that other company. A little company gets started in Germany called SUSE. I've heard it pronounced so many different ways by both English and German speakers, I no longer know, and frankly, I don't care anymore. The important thing is it's the other big business Linux distribution, and it's going to stay so. Now, SUSE is going to go through many jumps and bumps along its way, to say the least. I might as well go ahead and give you a little briefing on SUSE. I mean, these days, a lot of people are sort of hostile towards SUSE. That's because along the way, SUSE started out as this German company. Everybody kind of liked it. Okay, so they did support KDE and the Qt people. All right, but you know, people could live with that, sort of, kind of. But then they were bought by Novell, and people thought, oh no, they were going to lose it all to NetWare. How many of you ever used NetWare? Yeah, how many of you preferred NetWare to Linux? Yeah, exactly. This was not a pleasant thought. Fortunately, Novell at the time actually had the clever idea of, we will actually move all of our NetWare people over to SUSE Linux rather than try to mix them together. Or actually, they did try to mix them together. It's a little thing called Open Enterprise Server, but Open Enterprise Server never went anywhere. And unlike some companies I could name, when they saw that they had a bad idea, they dropped it rather than try to push it down everybody's throat. And so that worked out fairly well for them. And then, though, in 2006, Novell SUSE did something. And what happened in 2006 that made people really angry with them? They signed an agreement with Microsoft, in which the magic sauce appeared to be saying, well, yeah, you guys might have some patents that really maybe will apply to Linux. And, well, anyway, it sort of soured people on SUSE for a long time in the Pure community. Later, of course, other things happened with Novell, and SUSE eventually spins out to become its own company again, sort of, kind of. That's a long, complicated story. I won't bore you with the details about. Suffice it to say that to this day, though, SUSE maintains very strong relationships with Microsoft. They have a joint lab where they get together, where they work on interoperability and networking and so on. And maybe that's not such a bad thing after all, or not, depending on how your point of view about it. And shoving right along. Okay. Remember talking about KDE? People didn't like it that much? Well, finally, it took a while, but finally there was a reaction against KDE and its sort of Windows-like background and the whole Qt stuff, and that reaction was GNOME. And GNOME is going to, as most of you know, become wildly popular, especially once it hits the 2.0 mark. And it is the interface that for about, I would say a good 10 years or so is the interface of interfaces for most people. There are, of course, I know there are KDE fans out there. Please don't throw anything at me. But you know, it's true that for a while there, GNOME was the much more popular interface. You know, to jump ahead on the story, though, GNOME has its own troubles. GNOME's developers, for reasons which escape me, and I've talked to many of them, decided they wanted to sort of dump the entire 2.x interface thing and go their own way and create GNOME Free. Well, GNOME Free, what can I tell you about it? Linus Torvalds declares it to be an abomination upon the face of the waters and a truly horrible user experience. I agree. I really do. I really don't know quite what they're doing. So that it is, in 2012, according to the Linux Question Survey, which they did back in March, KDE is back to being the number one popular desktop. And GNOME has really, it's really forking badly right now. There is still the mainline GNOME 3.x line, which some of you know. At the same time, though, there's also a sort of fallback method in it, which sort of kind of looks like GNOME 2. But people aren't that enthusiastic about it. There's also a fork, which basically is called, it's called Mate. And Mate is essentially, Monte. Monte, yep, thank you. I always mispronounce that one. It's GNOME 2 revisited. And then there's this thing called Cinnamon, which is my personal favorite these days, which Linux Mint puts out. I highly recommend that you give it a try. Actually, at this point, I'm sort of vaguely curious. I've been talking about desktops, and you've all been looking at me so patiently. So here it is, 2012. How many KDE users do I have in the audience? This is like your preferred desktop. Fair minority. How many GNOME free users do I have? Oh my, more than I would have thought. Okay, Cinnamon, couple. Try it, you'll like it, trust me. Mate, few. Okay, looks like it's still KDE on top, GNOME following closely, and the two GNOME forks chasing them down. We'll see what happens next. Oh, yeah, you're right, XSCE. Okay, how many? Oh, yep. Goodly number. Anything more exotic? Pardon? Unity? Oh, you're right. How could I forget Unity? Shame on me. Actually, how many Unity fans do I have? Let's Unity hands up. Mark Shuttleworth would be really proud. That's actually many more than he would have, than people were telling me he would get. It has gotten a lot better, I quite agree. Those of you who read my stuff may know that I recently decided to put the Unity interface to the ultimate test. I gave it the new Ubuntu 12.04 system running Unity to my 89-year-old Spanish-speaking mother-in-law. You know how long it took her to learn how to use it? There was no learning curve. She could just use it. There was absolutely nothing to it. I was, by the way, I speak very little Spanish. She speaks very little English. So it wasn't like I could like give her any guidance or hardly any guidance anyway without my wife to translate between the two of us. So if you're in a position where you've got someone who is really computer clueless, and trust me, my mother-in-law was truly computer clueless. Actually, even if you think Unity is just too simple, too much of a kid's thing for you, try it on them. I think you'll be pleasantly surprised just how easy that will work for them. And oh, by the way, all these that we talked about, Monty and Cinnamon, all these others, they are all, in the end, based on GNOME. So GNOME, even though it may not be in and of itself the most popular now, is probably the most significant, though, of the desktop operating system, simply because of its influences on all these others. Okay, that happens. We're getting a little bit of push on the desktop. On the server space, Linux is beginning to catch on, and a company based in Redmond, Washington happens to notice this. And this company in Washington state, headed by some guy named Bill Gates, I think it was, yep, Bill Gates, decides that they need to start taking Linux seriously. Now, they're not going to announce that they're taking Linux seriously, not yet. But instead, they have these internal memos that Eric S. Raymond, a longtime friend of mine, discovered. And he called them the Halloween documents because of when he finds them. And they lay out that Microsoft is, one, really worried about this Linux thing, and two, lays out the plan of attack to how to try to knock it down. To sum up that attack in three words, the three words are fear, uncertainty, and doubt. This may sound very familiar to you. I think everyone here knows the acronym FUD. Well, here you go. The FUD begins in 1998. It is a deliberate attack on Microsoft. It's all, rather, by Microsoft on the Linux world. It's all very carefully planned out. And though Microsoft in some ways is being forced to see the error of their ways, that we're the enemy. It's not like we're fighting the way we once were, but still, from the very beginning, they don't like us, and they're coming after us. Why are they doing that? That's because by 1999, Linux is becoming pretty darn serious in the server space. Its percentage at this point, according to IDC, is only about 15%, but that's 15% out of nowhere, as far as Microsoft was concerned. At this point, Microsoft, thanks to Windows NT, is starting to really sort of own the server space. They are shoving down their chief rival at the time, NetWare and Novell. But this Linux thing, they're having a lot more trouble fighting because, among other things, Linux is free, you know? It's pretty hard to beat that. Also about this point, Linux is better than Windows at some jobs, particularly for things like edge servers and little local area network file servers and so on. And some people actually go out there and prove that, you know, if you just want your simple departmental print and file server, Linux and Samba, put them together, is actually better than Windows NT at the time. I happen to know that one for a fact because I'm the guy who went out there and did the benchmarking and proved that, yes, these are better. Actually, I'll give credit to my companion at ZD Labs at the time, a guy named Eric Carr. Between the two of us, we ran all the benchmarks, we did all the testing, and then we published the benchmarks and the testings. And you know what? Microsoft hasn't liked us ever since. I can't imagine why. I really can't. But we're not the only ones doing this, and Microsoft does their own set of benchmarks showing Windows is better, and then someone points out that the objective third party that had done this had actually been paid by Microsoft to do this. And so that didn't go, you know, and that doesn't go over too well for them. The word is getting out there. Not only is Linux cheap, Linux is better, and that's going to play an increasingly larger role in things as go along here. Everyone's starting to get excited about Linux, and at this point, we get odd companies moving in. The very first mass market Linux desktop, I'm not talking about a Linux desktop for the likes of you and me, people who are really into Linux. The first Linux desktop that's meant for everybody and anybody comes out. It's 1999. Comdex, which at the time was the biggest computer trade show in the world, oh, how the mighty have fallen, but they declare it sort of the year of Linux and so on. Corel jumps in and comes out with the first mass market for mom and dad Linux desktop. If many of you don't remember that, there's reasons for that. It's still not really quite ready for prime time. This is Someone say something? Okay. It's based on KDE. It actually works fairly well, but it never really catches on, in part because I believe the initial list price was $99.95. And, you know, enthusiasts liked it, but then enthusiasts already had a copy of Red Hat or SUSE or Slackware or Caldera. Let's not forget Caldera Linux is actually an important company at this point. Yeah, I know, bad things happen with Caldera, but we'll get to that. And Corel Linux actually eventually is spun off, in part because Corel runs out of money, and a company called Microsoft says, here, have some money, we'll keep you going for a while. But by the way, this Corel Linux stuff, if you could, like, kill it dead, we'd appreciate it. So they take about $80 million in funding, and Corel Linux is spun out into another company called Zandros. It actually turns into a pretty good little Linux distro, but they never really do quite master how to get it into the public world. And so this is one little branch of the Linux tree, which pretty much disappears. I believe there's actually, to this day, an embedded Linux based on the code that's it's one of those hot boot things. You turn it on, pop, up it comes. But it's, even in that world, it's a pretty minor player, alas, because I kind of liked it back in the day. And also, you could run WordPerfect on it, and that was pretty darn cool, being able to run WordPerfect on Linux, again, back in the day. Now, not so much. 2000, and this is a big one, okay? It's not a technology one. It's a pure business play. IBM looks at Linux and says, you know what? This is serious. This is really big. This is really important. We're going to spend $1 billion on Linux in the year 2000. And they do. They put out massive ad campaigns. They start supporting it on the entire family, mainframes, the various power-based systems, their X-based systems, the 386s, 40s, actually, we're talking early Pentiums and 46s then. They support it all along the line. Now, IBM is not going to build their own distro. At the time, there was a lot of thought, this is what's going to happen. They're going to build their own distribution. They don't do that. Instead, they partner up with Red Hat, they partner up with SUSE, they partner up temporarily with Caldera, a company we'll hear more about shortly. And that's what they're doing to this very day. Now, why do you think IBM did that? Yes, sir. Push hardware sales, that was part of it, but remember, they're already selling a lot of hardware. I mean, actually, ZOS is not bad, even to this very day. And AIX is actually a pretty darn spiffy Unix. If you have to use Unix, AIX is my Unix of choice to this very day. What they see, though, is that the future is going to belong to Linux. They really do see this early on, and they decide to bet big on it. It's also because they can run Linux on everything across their entire family line. Doesn't matter, you can buy a mainframe, you can buy the smallest little rack server with a 486 in it, it will all run the same operating system. They think that idea is wonderful. They love that idea. And they back it, and they're still backing it to this very day. And that gives Linux something it had not really had before. And that gives it the suddenly big business that they probably had at this point. Most big businesses had Linux skunk work projects, particularly in departments, in the engineering labs, they'd be running Linux. But now, the CIO can go in and say, you know what, IBM is backing this, we think we'll buy Linux. And of course, you know what, they were right, of course. Linux, for this $1 billion that IBM put in, they have gotten hundreds of billions of dollars since then. In service, in sales, it really worked out really well for IBM. In fact, you could argue, and in fact, I would argue that IBM remains the major force that it does in computing today because of its embrace in Linux. Because if some of you may recall, IBM for a while was not doing that well. You know, OS 2, great little system, went nowhere. Their sales were beginning to fall off. Sun was giving them fits in the mid-range. They no longer had any real play in the smaller range. Linux, in many ways, made it possible for IBM to become the industry giant that it is again today. Yes, sir. Yep.
And Walmart, you ever go to back to Walmart store to look to see two servers fail? And you go to Bentonville, Arkansas, you got a couple of IBM G Series mainframes. One runs this thing, it's got something like 800 instances of Linux, of Blaze and virtualization, really where IBM went up big R. And then they have a second one. And so from that moment on, a lot of people, IBM salespeople that I know, who go out and say, just remember this.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Thanks for the anecdote. I'd actually forgotten that one, but yeah. And trust me, that made a big impact on people. And they could trust it, they could believe in it. And gosh, I don't know I'd ever say thank you, Walmart, but okay, thank you, Walmart, for that. Okay. Well, actually, before I go to this one, I should also mention something else happens in 2000. Up until this point, every bit of code that goes into the Linux kernel is going through Linus. Every lousy bit. He touches it by hand. This isn't working so well anymore. You know, Linux is starting to get really big, get a lot of developers coming in, a lot of code. Linus is becoming a bit of a bottleneck. So there's a meeting in San Francisco called the Twin Peaks meeting, where basically a bunch of the core developers sit down with Linus and say, you know what, we've got to do something. You can't do it all by yourself. And Linus actually still wants to do it by himself. It's a long argument. I should really write a story about it at some point, because nobody really has written that out, as far as I know, and actually what happened at the Twin Peaks meeting. But at the end of it all, Linus agrees that, yes, he can't do it all. He starts giving some of it off to other people, and they decide, you know what, maybe having a better system for managing our software and keeping track of changes is a good idea. 2001, Linux 2.4 appears. 2.4 is, I think, Linus and I disagree on this one, but I think it's the most important single release because that's the one where clustering really becomes possible. You start to be able to address memory in truly significant ways. Non-uniform memory architecture comes along. This is the one where instead of just running instances, individual instances, you can really start getting all these hooks things together so you can start building what eventually are going to become Linux supercomputers and what are eventually going to become truly massive, what appear to be single instances of Linux, even though underneath the surface it's not really that. This is the one which takes Linux to being an honest-to-God, no-questions-asked competitor with the like of Solaris and AIX and all the other big Unixes. This is it. A company called Red Hat, remember them? They see this. They see this coming. And they say, you know what? At this time, let me bring up my notes here, because this part I don't remember quite clearly enough. We've done really well, the people at Red Hat says, Bob Young and Paul Cormier. But you know what? We can't do well anymore just selling Linux to individual users. We've got to move away from it. We have got to instead focusing on releases meant for individual users and small businesses. We need to focus entirely on the enterprise. Big business. IBM is there. You got customers like Walmart who are buying into this. 2.4 gives us the ability to really extend Linux into enterprise size loads. So they decide to let go of their small business, the individual box. Some of you remember the individual boxes with Red Hat 9 and so on inside of them. They let that business go. How popular do you think that move was? Oh, brother. Paul tells me that people wanted him fired. I know this is true because the engineers who wanted him fired at the time, this is Red Hat internal engineers, said, yeah, fire him. Fire him now. He's the one who came up with this idea. And the user community revolts. Many of you may not remember this, but there were a lot of people who wanted nothing more to do with Red Hat at this time. Not a darn thing, because they felt like they were being abandoned. And you know, in a way they sort of were, but you know, this was a strategic decision. Red Hat wanted to know, did we still want to be a company, probably the biggest of the companies, but still basically small companies, or do we want to try for something really big? And they decided to go for really big. They retired out the Red Hat Linux line. Red Hat Linux 9 was the last of them. They started something called Fedora. I think people here know about Fedora, yes? Yep, which is the community build that was both to give them something to build up into their Red Hat Enterprise Linux series and also to make those Red Hat Linux people, the ones they had sort of left behind, give them something. And that actually worked out really well for them in the end. And actually, of course, the name of what Red Hat's main project really says it all. It is Red Hat Enterprise Linux, as we all know. The name starts in 2002. Ah, yes. All together. Okay, we can do it all together. All right. I know this story much better than I really want to. I really do. Pamela Jones and I. Oh, by the way, PJ, Pamela Jones of Grok Law, she is a real person. She's not made up. She's not an IBM lawyer. She's a friend of mine and so on. And we followed this story to the ground. I'm not going to give you that full song and dance. We'd be here for a week. Quick background. Once upon a time, there was a nice company called SCO, Santa Cruz Operations. They made a nice Unix. They actually, for a while, did you know that Microsoft used to sell Unix? They did, SCO Unix, or actually it was rebranded Microsoft Unix. And you could run, excuse me, SCO Unix on an 8086, running at 4.77 megahertz. I know this because I did. Do you know what would you like to know what it was like to run Unix on a 4.77 megahertz system with 64K of memory was like? The word you want is slow, beyond slow. But anyway, they get better though. They actually create some pretty good Unix systems and so on. But you know what? PC Unix doesn't have much of a market anymore because this thing called Linux came along. SCO Unix was fine against the BSDs because the BSDs were and still are today incredibly disorganized, and they fight more with each other than a bunch of Debian developers after a beer fest. And that's saying, some of you know. So there they are on one side. On the other side, you have a company called Caldera. Now largely forgotten except for people like me and other Linux people who were there at the time. And Caldera was actually a pretty darn good Linux company. You could argue that in 2002, 2003, that there were really three big Linux companies. It was SUSE, Caldera, and Red Hat. And at that point, really, it was kind of anybody's guess who was going to win. Because remember, Red Hat had been the biggest, but what did they just do the year before? They really ticked off their user base is what they did. Then bad things happen. The owner of Caldera got really sick, and he basically had Alzheimer's, and he kind of lost it, and it went to his assistant. His assistant decided several things, one of which was we should merge with SCO, which actually, that move actually sort of made sense. The biggest Intel Unix vendor getting together with a big Linux player. Okay, that makes sense. At the time, the thought was that they would bring them together, they would take everything out of the Unix kernel they could, and they would open source it, and this would be grand, and this would be wonderful. But the guy who was owning Caldera actually, said, no, we don't want to do this. So he fired the head of Caldera, a guy named Ransom Love, who's a great guy, by the way. If you ever have a chance to meet him, do. These days he works on genealogy software for the Mormon Church of all things. And they bring in this other guy named Darold Darf. Darf Vader McBride. Yeah, and along with the guy who hired him, they decide that this Linux company, which has been selling Linux, giving Linux away, contributing to the code, that they would sue IBM for distributing Linux. Now, remember, IBM actually doesn't make a Linux, okay? we have a failure of logic right there. They go after them. They go after all these companies using Linux. This is a mess. It goes on for too many years. I don't need to preach to you why it was a really stupid idea to begin with, but it's a really stupid idea. It actually, though, I would suggest, has one good effect, though. Remember I talked about the Twin Peaks meeting? Remember I talked about how people are disenchanted with Red Hat? But I also recall how I was talking about how KDE and GNOME were fighting with each other then. There's actually, at this point in time, there's a lot of discontent in the Linux community. We're all pretty darn grumpy with each other. But now, and this is really ironic actually in a way, thanks to SCO, suddenly everybody's got a much bigger single enemy in mind. And the Linux and communities unite to fight this threat. It's going to take years. It's going to take a long fight. We look at it now and we can say, you know, the case was stupid. They were always going to lose. Well, yeah, the case was stupid. They were always going to lose. But at the time, those big businesses, They were a little scared of this. They were seriously frightened of the idea that they might actually owe someone serious money for intellectual property damages, which unfortunately is a theme we're going to hear more about as we go through here. This is the case where, for the first time, all this crap about intellectual property, copyrights, and later patents starts to come in. Before that, yes, there are patent lawsuits. Yes, there are fights about code copyright, but nobody takes it the way we do today, where it becomes a gigantic legal fight where your work and your productivity sometimes is affected by it. And it all starts here. But as I said, the one small silver lining about this was that in 2003, when Linux really needed something to unify it, the SCO very ironically actually helped put that all together for us. So thank you, Daryl McBride, something that I never thought I would say at the time. Okay. Remember Debian again? I talked about how it was so slow moving. Wow, gosh. Mark Shuttleworth, nice South African boy, decides, you know what? He really loves the idea of open source. He loves the idea of spreading this idea around to people. I know some people sort of look at Mark Shuttleworth and say, he's a little too slick or something, but I don't think you should ever, or he's a little too full of himself, don't ever forget he starts this because he loves open source, he loves the idea of sharing stuff, and you know what? He's still that guy today, really. He really is. That's what I think anyway. I've known him for, well, since 2004, come to think about it. Interject. That is true. That's like, I don't think you've told me that one before. That's neat. I didn't know that she had met him then. What Mark does is, yes, actually he makes no bones about it. Yeah, Debian. He's always said that. Yep, it's based purely on Debian. Okay, so he doesn't say the Linux word that often anymore, but it's based on Debian. Says it now, says it then. And this is the one, because he thinks this is a system for everyone, not just for the techie elite, not just for, you know, unlike Red Hat, who thinks of it as the enterprise only. He says, let's make this, you know, Linux for everyone, Ubuntu, sharing it. And that idea is a really powerful one, and it has worked fairly well in making Ubuntu popular. Now, Ubuntu has taken some shifts along the way, and sometimes they've annoyed some people, but to this day, he's still working on it. He's still trying to popularize Linux. They're making much more of a business play now than they ever used to. They're also trying to play in the enterprise space. But unlike Red Hat, they never intend upon leaving the user community behind. I've talked to Mark about this. He says, you know, it's just, yeah, Red Hat model worked really well for them. That's not what I'm interested in. And I think that's significant because really Canonical, the company behind Ubuntu, it really doesn't make much money at all from Ubuntu. In fact, you could argue it doesn't at all. They're privately held companies. I've never had a chance to look at their books. Not that I would, but, well, you know, if they were just sitting there, I might, you know, but, you know, I mean, he spends tens of millions. I mean, he's got it to spend, but still, you know, he could be, you know, building yachts and putting lasers on tops of shark heads, like, you know, well, are there Oracle people here? Okay. So anyway, he could be that, but no, he's not. He's still working on it, and Ubuntu to this very day, it remains extremely popular. And he's with things like the Unity interface, which I mentioned a few minutes ago, really easy to use. That's part of the whole idea of making this something that not only you can use, but your grandpa, your grandma, whoever. Oh, mousy, 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 where are you? Ah, there you are. Okay. Links are getting to be a big deal again. Now it's really going places. Before, Microsoft was basically reacting to the threat. Now it's getting real. And doesn't Linus look totally uncomfortable there? He really, you know, he's just not really a guy to put on a suit. I don't know how, you know, I've seen him occasionally, but this doesn't happen very often. At this point, IDC says that Linux servers are now 35% of all servers. That's serious. It's no longer NetWare is number two. No, it's Linux is now number two and coming on fast. So fast that even mainstream business publications like Business Week see this happening and they take it seriously. One quote from the Business Week story goes something like this. Steve Ballmer keeps telling people that Windows is both better and cheaper. The simple truth is it's not. That wasn't a Linux supporter. That wasn't even a tech guy. That was just a straight nothing but dollars and cents business person saying, you know what, this is better, this is cheaper, Microsoft has something to worry about. And of course, you know, they were right. Now Linux at this time, still preying primarily on the server, doing a little bit of stuff on the desktop, but now there are these new things coming along. They look something like, well, like this, as a matter of fact. Yep, I think most of us have them. Or something quite like them. If you have an iPhone, well, okay. I forgive you, they are awful pretty. But IBM has also been, rather, Linux has always been playing in the embedded space as well. By this time the Android has come along, there's already a device called the TiVo out there. First major digital video recorder. What does the first TiVo have in it? It has Linux. What do almost all the DVRs have in them? Linux. What do a lot of just basic home appliances have? Linux. But almost all those are one-off Linux. They're made by embedded developers for this one device. They're written, their kernels, everything is written just for that one device. That's it. There are attempts to make a united embedded Linux. Those attempts really don't go much of anywhere. At this point, there are probably, gosh, this is 2007 I'm talking. There's at least a dozen embedded Linux companies out there. I mean, not just, you know, one guy operation. I mean, seriously trying to do something here. But one company comes up with this thing called Android. Google looks it over and says, you know what? We can do something with this. And they do. They get together with a bunch of the handset vendors and they get them to agree, companies like Samsung and HTC and Motorola, companies which, by the way, have no love whatsoever for each other. They can't stand each other. But they get them to agree that rather than continuing to spend a ton of money working on their own Linux distributions or using something like Symbian OS, which just is not getting the job done, that instead they should all unite on this one platform called Android. Google will maintain it, they will open source it, though Google goes back and forth on exactly how open it is at any given moment, and that everyone can agree with this. And off they go. Today, the number one operating system on smartphones is, drum roll please, Android. Oh, come on, we need more enthusiasm. Say it with me. Android, thank you, there we go. Now we're preaching to the, okay, very good back there. All right, and it looks like it's going to stay that way. iOS, yes, iPhones are wonderful, but they're a minority in the market, which I think is what Apple wants with them, by the way. I don't think Apple really wants to. I think if Apple ever had something that became 51% of the market, they'd double the price, add in something else, and, you know, that's not what Apple's thing is. Android, I think, is going to be really happy being the number one mobile system for quite some time, and I expect eventually it's going to be the number one platform on the tablet as well. Not because necessarily it's prettier, but because it simply is inexpensive and not everybody can afford. What is the minimum price for an iPad 2 original edition now? Is it $400, $350? You know, I mean, that's a lot of money, you know? It really is. And for all those other people, that mass market, eventually someone's going to really perfect the Android tablet. Maybe it'll be Samsung, maybe conceivably Amazon. We'll just have to see how that comes out. And dropping back for a moment and pulling back, remember the SEO wars? How intellectual property law starts coming into play? Welcome to the mobile space. For all that SEO gave us a lot of nonsense, it is nothing compared to the patent, copyright, trademark, design wars that we see in the mobile space today. We have our victories there. Oracle had their teeth kicked in by Google recently in their lawsuit against Android over patents, yep. You know, no other way to put it. I know a lot of Oracle people who will never ever say this in public because you never know where Larry is listening, but they pretty much agree it was a dumb lawsuit to begin with, and they got busted. But we're not done by any means. Motorola, which now belongs to Google as of about 2 weeks ago, is locked into lawsuits with Microsoft. Apple and Samsung are fighting around the world. They are fighting in the courts in Belgium, Germany, Australia, Austria, Canada, the United States, South Korea. Is that everybody? Maybe. No, France. We're not talking single lawsuits. We're talking lawsuits in each of these countries. These are not one massive lawsuit that's somehow being done globally. They're fighting over basically every possible intellectual property issue you can. I have hopes, I really do, that Tim Cook is going to wake up and say, you know what? We don't need to do this anymore. This is stupid. I would much rather compete in the marketplace rather than in the courtroom. And actually, since I think Apple in the end has more to lose than all the forces of Android put together, I think that's quite possible. Because Apple, one company, one thing, if they get a major loss anywhere, they're in trouble. For example, for a while, you couldn't buy iPads in Germany. Do they want to say that happened in the United States and say the Christmas season? I don't think so. I think it'd be much smarter for them to stop all this stuff. Unfortunately, that's just my hope. For the time being, we're still locked in a world. We're going to continue to see open source products, particularly Android, but anything in the mobile space is going to face a lot of intellectual property fights. And I wish that would go away, but it's not going to. Meanwhile, back with big business and enterprise. Remember how Walmart took them up and all these other big businesses? Server numbers are going up. Companies that are about as mission critical as you can get, not mission critical in the terms of life support or medical, but mission critical as far as business is concerned. And you don't get any more mission critical than stock exchanges. They depend upon having the right information to the right people in milliseconds every time. Tens of millions of transactions every day. How did they do it? They used to do it with mainframes, God help them. Then they used to use a lot of Solaris and Spark boxes. Wasn't adequate. I think Toronto tried AIX for a while. Not adequate. They finally discovered the best and fastest way of doing this inexpensively was Linux. 2007, 2008, the New York Stock Exchange moves to RHEL, Red Hat Enterprise Linux. Remember, Enterprise, Red Hat, yep, it's working for them big time. At this point, I haven't done the numbers recently, but I believe in end of 2011, 7 out of 10 of the major world stock exchanges are running on Linux. The rest of them are in transition to Linux. By 2014, I don't think there's going to be a major stock exchange in the world not running Linux. There were attempts early on for Windows to try to get into this market. The London Stock Exchange comes to mind as one that tried a Windows solution. Oh my, what a wonderful day that was when a .NET stack, yeah, they built it out of .NET, running on Server 2000, not 2003, 2000. It crashed, went down for about 7 hours. Couple of billions of pounds lost later, they decided that Linux was really the better way to go. And I don't think anyone will ever, ever try to win Windows Server again in a stock exchange. It was just ugly. Ugly, ugly, ugly. Come here, mouse. There we go. That's the business world. You know what? Linux is making big impacts in other places, though. Remember talking about 2.4, how you could cluster and all that good stuff? Supercomputers are now a major play for Linux. At this point in time, according to the last top 500, 93.1% of the top 500 supercomputers in the world run, come on, Linux, thank you, there we go. And there's a reason for that. It clusters well, it's inexpensive, it just works, you know? Bottom line is, it just works. Same time that's going on, there's some interesting work on not so much artificial intelligence, but expert systems going on. IBM is a leader there. Expert systems, for those of you who don't know, it's an idea that probably goes back to at least the 50s. The idea is if you put all the data about a certain subset of problems into a computer, you'll be able to take that computer and it can answer questions. It may not be able to answer questions about everything, but it can answer questions about that certain subset. Expert systems, though, lovely ideas they are, never really have worked all that well. If there are any expert systems people out there who think theirs run just fine, sorry to have, but you know, most of them didn't. IBM, though, and their Watson program, though, worked really hard on it, and they eventually got to the point where they could come up with an expert system on general trivia. That system, of course, is Watson, and Watson, as you may recall, took on the two best human Jeopardy players of all time, Ken Jennings, and I forget the name of the other fellow. Anyone know? Oh, well. Nope. Okay. In any case, nope, not the people up there. That was a test run. and it beat them actually rather soundly. Now, at the moment, let's see. I don't see the fellow who's working on it here, but there's actually IBM, or do I? That's right. You don't start that job till next week. At the moment, there's still trouble with it, but expert systems based on Watson technology are going to be coming for healthcare, where basically you tell it what's wrong, it feeds in data, and it's going to be able to give you, you know, a decent idea of what's wrong with you and so on. Pharmaceuticals, a lot of other industries where human expertise is expensive, and it would be really nice to have at least a first filter of an expert system that could say, hey, you know, you've just got a tummy ache, or hey, you have appendicitis, get thee to a surgeon right now. All this is coming, all this, of course, is Linux-based. Yay, Linux. Something else is going on as well. As I think all of us know here, we love Linux. Most of us love Linux on the laptop or the desktop. That's what I run, have for years and years now. But bottom line is Linux is still about 1% of the desktop. That may change, though. One reason why it may change is we're now moving towards cloud-based computing. It's no longer as important to have all the power right here beside you in one of these. You can have a lot of your compute power, a lot of your storage out there on a cloud somewhere. At the moment, we're putting a lot of server stuff on there. We're beginning to really like the idea of putting local storage, though, on there. Or not local storage, remote storage. How many people have Dropbox accounts here? Yep, goodly number. G Drive, Ubuntu Drive. Yep, exactly. I've got all of them. They're pretty darn handy, aren't they, so long as you have high-speed network.
If you have that, you are staying in this hotel.
Yes. Actually, I got Dropbox to work great here for some reason. I was lucky. I guess I must have been. Google, though, says, you know what? There's so much stuff out there that we already do, Google Docs, Google Mail, so on, that, you know, 95% of what you do in a day, activities, you can actually already do on the web. And Google, by the way, has all these nifty applications they would like you to use on the web. Why can't we just give people a web browser, say, oh, I don't know, Chrome, for example, just because, and put it on top of a really thin layer of Linux, which, by the way, is an Ubuntu Linux, heavily modified by Google, but it's actually Ubuntu has, and Canonical's people have worked a lot on it. Let's call this thing Chromos, and let's see if it takes off. So far, it hasn't, but it's an attractive idea. And as people get more and more used to the idea of doing their work on the cloud, I think, personally, that it's an idea that may fly. Now, one reason I think that's going to fly is that I see Microsoft getting ready to make yet another one of their big strategic dumb mistakes. And that strategic dumb mistake is called Windows 8 and Aereo. Metro. Aero was the last one. You know what? Windows 7 and Metro, it's not bad. I'm up here, I'm a Linux guy, I've just said it, Windows 7 actually isn't bad. Windows 8, on the other hand, you know, I don't care if you love Windows, and I know a lot of people who love Windows and think it's the greatest thing and say they would never ever use Linux as they are, you know, searching for something on Google and writing to someone on Facebook, both of which are Linux, but you know, hey, they don't know, they don't care. That hardcore community, which would never ever move off Windows, are going to look at Metro and they're going to freak out. They have no clue what's about to hit them because it is so utterly different from anything that they have seen before. The difference between UniFi and GNOME 2 is nothing, as is the difference between traditional Windows desktops and Metro. It's going to freak people out, and I think some of them are at least are going to think about switching over. And Google is a big company. You may have noticed there's a lot of Chrome ads. There's a reason for all those ads. They want to get that, they know they're not selling them now, but they want to get that idea in your mind that there's an alternative. And you look at this. You could use that, right? Anybody here could use this interface. It's familiar. It's something that people would feel comfortable with, and Google is going to hammer that point with a really big hammer in about 3 or 4 months, and then we'll see what happens. Now, the last time Microsoft put their foot in it was Vista. And Vista was a flop, and you know what? And Linux then actually made a strong push in the desktop. It really did. It didn't, not by on these machines, but on netbooks. Remember netbooks? Netbooks, for the longest time, ran Linux. They were great. They were underpowered and small, but hey, then sometimes that's all you needed. Which, by the way, Google, Chrome, okay, yeah, it may not do much, but hey, it's all you need. Same sort of thing, except bigger displays and so on. What Microsoft did then, though, was they realized, though they will never ever admit it, they had made a serious strategic mistake with Vista. XP was due to die. They decided for some reason XP should not die after all. I can't imagine why. And instead, they made XP Home in particular. They went to Asus and all these other people who had were making netbooks at the time and said, listen, you. we know you're not selling Vista, but we'll tell you what, we'll sell you XP for basically a song and a dance if you just get rid of these darn netbooks. And they were able to do that. And so it is that XP Home lived, the netbook movement died. But we're going to have another opportunity here. And this time, rather than, you know, little relatively small companies like Asus, you've got Google on the other side saying, you know what? We can do something here. And I think this is going to be a very interesting to see how this interaction goes. I'm not going to bet against Microsoft, because if nothing else, what I think is really going to happen is the majority of users are just going to stick with Windows 7. They're going to stick with XP. But some of them, maybe enough of them that Linux is going to catch up with Mac OS X, are going to shift over to this. Some of them are also going to look and see what Google does with combining Android and Chrome. That could happen as well, too. And we'll just see what happens here. It's going to be a very interesting next year or two in the desktop space. Going back to Red Hat, remember when they made that bet? They bet there would be more money by playing straight to the enterprise market. You think they won the bet? I do. $1 billion. Any way you want to measure it, Red Hat is the first $1 billion Linux company. Pure play Linux company, I should say, because a lot of other companies, like, say, IBM, have made, at this point, hundreds of billions. Oracle, for that matter. You know, we think of Oracle in many ways, but you know something else about Oracle? Oracle is a largely Linux-based company. You know what? They make tons of money. Lots of other companies do. Google runs on Linux. Facebook runs on Linux. You know, it's not present on the desktop, so in some ways we still feel like we're sort of like the little David fighting Goliath. We're not really. We are now on the internet. We're the giant in the enterprise space, server space, mission critical. We're the giant. Microsoft is actually in retreat, which is one reason why this week, Thursday, Microsoft announced the newest version of Azure, which is their cloud system. Okay, what does Azure do that's new and different?
It advertises on SourceForge.
That's true. Well, actually, they've often advertised on SourceForge, but yeah. I'll tell you what they did. Azure now has virtual images of Ubuntu Linux on it, OpenSUSE, SUSE Linux Enterprise Server, and CentOS. Not Red Hat, not yet anyway. Four major Linux distributions are now available for you to purchase, or actually, you can use free for now for 90 days, and then it's the cheap price thereafter for every hour. But Microsoft is now giving you their cloud platform to run Linux on. To quote Linus, if Microsoft ever does applications for Linux, it means I've won. Well, Microsoft doesn't do much in the way of applications now, but they have made their cloud operating system Linux friendly. That's pretty darn close to what he said. So I think you can say they won. We've won even in the land of Microsoft. Why did Microsoft do this? They had no choice. They had no choice. Their customers were coming to them and saying, yes, we'll run Windows 7, you know, on our desktops, but we want to run Linux as our servers. If you want us to run on your cloud, we need Linux. And that's why they're doing it. The raw numbers, again, they wanted to admit to it, but I've talked to Microsoft customers, and this is what they tell me. This isn't just what people are telling me. This isn't just hearsay as a reporter who's been in the business for a long time. We do have hard numbers on the Amazon public cloud. At this point, there are at any given moment, according to the Cloud Foundry, which tracks this, there's about 40,000 Linux instances running on the public Amazon cloud at any given moment. There are 3,000 Windows instances running on the Amazon cloud at any moment. And it doesn't cost you really significantly. If you do micro instances, it doesn't cost you pretty much anything to have running Windows there. So this isn't cost. This is people saying, we want Linux, and not say it, they're doing it. So it is that I've come to the end of my talk, and we're up to 2012. And you know, it's sort of a curious feeling, because we've won in many ways, but it doesn't really quite feel like it. So I think sometimes when you think about this whole operating system world that you're in, you should congratulate yourselves for being on the winning side, realize that we are indeed on the winning side, and appreciate the fact that together, starting with that finished graduate student, just putting together a little project that he wouldn't do anything, we have created an operating system revolution which has truly changed the world. Thank you. Do I have any time for questions, or? I do? Okay, I guess I do have time for Q&A, or not. Any questions, comments, insults? Yes, sir. They really don't play in the same place. Of course, okay. I assume everyone knows here that Apple Mac OS X is actually a Unix. It is. It's BSD Unix at its core, which also explains something there too, because there's so little interaction between the BSD worlds and the Linux worlds. For a while there, you could get the source code. Actually, you can still get the older versions of the source code for BSD Unix that powers Mac OS. It's called Darwin. It's worth checking out. It's more of historical interest these days than anything else. But there's really been very little interaction between the two. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Not really a question, but you mentioned before that we're still about 1% on the desktop.
Yep.
I would like to point out that Microsoft disagrees with you. Microsoft estimates Linux on the desktop at 3-5%, about equal to OS X.
Microsoft's numbers are weird. I don't really know where they get their numbers from. Yeah.
World,
they might be right. Actually, in that case, yeah, the world is probably up 3-5. We don't see a lot of it here, but particularly in Southeast Asia, there's actually a lot of Linux play. Ubuntu, actually, is a serious, I mean, here, if you went to a Best Buy or your local store, you try to buy a Windows machine, you can't do it. But if you were in, say, Phnom Penh in Cambodia or Hanoi in Vietnam, you could go to a store and they actually have Ubuntu machines ready to go to buy. Mark Shuttleworth recently said that he expects to sell 20 million units of Ubuntu this year. And a lot of people thought, what have you been smoking, Mark? He hasn't really been smoking anything. What he's really talking about is the world market. And particularly in that market, again, the Asian market, they're actually doing really pretty darn well for themselves. Yeah.
LPI Boston was talking this morning. He sort of went by a lot of people, but he mentioned, I don't know if you get it, LPI, their stuff is much more popular outside of the United States. They really make very little effort. He's only been there about a year. And they're only starting to track the U.S. LPI Linux certification. A former coworker. India, very big IT
No, this is Robin Miller, Rob Limo, by the way. Yep. So, and he's quite right. There's actually good money to make in this country as a sysadmin with doing Linux. Be there, never any doubt. But if you've always wanted to see India, this is actually a nice way of doing it because there really are the jobs out there. Other questions, comments? Yes, sir.
For the GNU, of course.
Oh, GNU, okay. Good enough. This is true. While we can't ignore the fact that, I should address this point. I was talking earlier about the Berkeley systems, the BSDs, how they always fought with each, they still to this day fight with each other, and they've never really gotten, I mean, there are very important systems, actually, like the Mac that run on it, but you'd never know that the Mac runs on BSD. There are important big websites that run on it. Yahoo, I believe, is still running a fair number of their servers still on BSD, and I know Netflix is. Every time you watch a Netflix video, it's because it's FreeBSD in the background, and it's the one doing the streaming, along with Nginx, it's the web server. But the key reason, I think, and that we didn't have that sort of fragmentation that affected the BSD universe is because of the GPL. The GPL makes it so that you can share your work, but everybody else has to share it as well. The BSD license, you can take it, you can do anything you want with it, you don't have to give it back. And the GPL universe, because by its very nature, we must work together. If you're going to develop anything and try to distribute it anywhere other than your own little itty-bitty company, you've got to work together, and I think that's been one of the glues that has kept Linux together and kept it from being just another obscure operating system that only obscure operating system geeks like me would know about. Going once, going twice. At this point, I will turn it over to one of these gentlemen here. Thank you very much for your time.
Thanks, Stephen. All right, we're going to get started with the raffle, but before we do, I want to get you or remind you that there will be another raffle tomorrow.
When we created Asterisk over a decade ago, we could not have imagined that Asterisk would not only become the most widely adopted open source communication software on the planet, but that it would impact the entire industry in the way that it has. Today, Asterisk has found its way into more than 170 countries and virtually every Fortune 1000 company.
The success of Asterisk has enabled a transition of power from the hands of the traditional proprietary phone vendors into the hands of the users and the administrators of phone systems. Using this power, our customers have created all sorts of business-changing applications, from small office phone systems to mission-critical call centers to international carrier networks. In fact, there's even an entire country whose communications infrastructure runs on Asterisk.
Digium has always been about creating technology that expands communications capabilities in ways that we could never have imagined. And that's part of what's game-changing about Digium. Today, we're doing it again, this time by introducing a new family of HDIP phones that extends control of the user all the way to the desktop.
The launch of these new products represents the next phase in Digium's history of innovation. These are the first and only IP phones designed to fully leverage the power of Asterisk. When we first discussed our expectations for building a family of phones for use with Asterisk, our requirements were pretty simple. We asked the team to build the phones such that they were easy to install, integrate, provision, and use. I think you'll soon agree our engineers have delivered on that goal. User feedback is validating that when it comes to operation with Asterisk-based systems, including our own SwitchFox-based product, these are the easiest to use, best integrated, most interoperable products on the market today. The Digium family of phones will initially include three IP desk phones, uniquely designed to complement any Asterisk or SwitchFox-based solution. These phones are different for a number of reasons. First, they're exclusively designed for use with Asterisk. Secondly, we've made it really easy to auto-discover and provision the phones. Next, we've made it easy for the phones to access information inside of Asterisk, allowing tight coupling between an application and the phone. Additionally, we've created an applications engine that allows users and developers to create and run their own apps on the phone. And finally, we've done all of this at a very compelling price point. At Digium, we're always thinking of ways to give our customers the best value in business phone systems and also give them the power to create their own solutions for any communications challenge.
We'll continue to push the boundaries, not only to make Asterisk cooler and faster and more technologically feature-rich, but to make Asterisk and VoIP communications even easier.
And together, we'll change the way the world communicates.
Again.
Cloud stacks are everywhere.
This is the way to better utilize all your resources, and it makes managing all your resources pretty easy.
All of the innovation is happening in open source.
The collaborative nature and of the you know of the community and the speed at which these deficiencies, these bugs are getting discovered and then fixed is a thing that really shows the power of the of the open source community.
It is global, and it's definitely because of the users.
Community people are extremely friendly and always ready to help.
If you go onto IRC any day, you'll see these guys helping each other out, and they're all doing it like in a selfless manner.
The product is transparent for everyone. Everyone can look at the code base. Everyone can see how CloudStack is being built. Nothing is proprietary. Everything is open.
In many ways, it's absolutely vital to the ongoing health of CloudStack.
The most exciting event in recent memory for me was our first developer boot camp. And our call gave people, I think, maybe 2 weeks notice to come attend. I was expecting 25 or 30 people. So we ended up with 87 people and had to go get more chairs into the room twice.
Everything within cloud computing is commodity and is open source. And so I don't think that you will you'll see anywhere where open source is not pervasive in cloud computing. And so I think it's an assumption. I think when you talk about cloud computing, you're really talking about open source cloud computing.
CloudStack is a robust solution for large deployments.
You have dozens of data centers and thousands of servers in each data center. These hardware is going to fail, and CloudStack is designed to handle, number one, that mass scale. Number two, it's designed to handle the failure that inevitably happens in large deployments.
We started working on CloudStack over 4 years ago, and it was the original set of people working on it had a background of delivering software to telcos and service providers.
Lots of QA, lots of users actually using it.
High availability is the key feature. Multiple hypervisor support, different network models. You can pick up whatever suits you better.
CloudStack Management Server can be deployed in different physical machines.
It definitely has a huge footprint. It's being deployed everywhere.
There's a major movie studio that they were using CloudStack. They were using it to transcode video. And I thought that was terribly fascinating. What I found more fascinating is what they did during lunch, where they would spin up 50 or 60 game servers, then as soon as lunch was over, they would destroy all the instances and go back to doing real work.
CloudStack is vast. It touches so many different aspects, and there's no one person that's kind of like a master of all those realms.
I think CloudStack as a project is going to be one of the leaders, simply because it's some of the most featureful and and robust platforms out there.
I don't see any limits with the cloud stack.